Let us pray. Almighty God, our Redeemer, in our weakness we have failed to be your messengers of forgiveness and hope. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, that we may follow your commands to proclaim and proclaim, proclaim, proclaim your reign of love through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Welcome to Christ United Presbyterian Church, a Christian church within the Presbyterian family of churches. I want to offer in the welcome today kudos to our ushers. Lots of different changes happening week to week and lots of different sources of drama week to week. And I just want to extend from the pulpit kudos to our ushers. Good to see Sister Dolores and family today. Haven't seen Dolores in a minute in the house of the Lord. So good to see Dolores and Master Chief. How you doing, sir? All right, good to see you. And good to see everybody. There's a lot of different places people can be. Coffee is good and it gets better and better in the culture and society. So glad that you could take some time to worship the Lord in the context of community today. And want to remind you that every first Sunday, we do collect money for the Deacon Fund. The deacons are really busy assisting with funerals and providing repasts, and so that's helpful. And if you don't have a deacon envelope, we'll get you next month if there's not a deacon envelope in your seat or near your seat. The last thing I want to share in the way of a welcome is, in May, we are going to have a town hall meeting. And the purpose of the town hall meeting is to discuss some things that the session and I have discussed. We've talked about the vision that I've had for this corner for over 9 years of being a hub for the community. A hub that serves the needs of the community, both secular and sacred needs. There's one thing this church has that's in short supply in this community, and that is space. And we can share our space with others, to assist others, to serve others in this community, and we can do it to the glory of God. So some of those ideas that coordinate with that will be discussed in the town hall meeting. We'll get a chance to hear your feedback. One of the ideas is, you might remember we had the neighbor's church that used to meet in the parking lot here. Maybe the two of us, since they are full of 20, 30-year-olds and having babies by the minute, if they partner with us on the same campus, we could cover the population from cradle literally to grave together as a witness to Christ, have all ages covered sufficiently and in a good number. I've written a white paper about some of the changes, and if you like a copy, please ask me. And there's some other things that will come along, and we can discuss those in the town hall meeting. Meanwhile, let us continue in worship. Ain't I glad I got out the wilderness?
Got out the wilderness, got out the wilderness, got out. takes away the sins of the world. Oh, come along, Lord, and run out the wilderness, run out the wilderness, run out the wilderness. Come along, Lord, and run out the wilderness, leaning on the Lord. Oh, come along, Lord, and run out the wilderness, run out the wilderness, run out the wilderness. Come along, Lord, and run out the wilderness, leaning
Maybe no one's had to get out of the wilderness in this house. I don't know. So let me just continue with worship, since y'all saintly and everything. And we'll open ourselves up to God's love by sharing in this prayer together. Let us share together with boldness, the boldness of faith. Everlasting God, fountain of all life, and true home of every heart. Our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Yet we confess that our hearts have been enslaved by selfish passion and base desire. We have sought many other and have neglected the one thing needful. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. Help us to turn to you and find forgiveness. Lead us home that we may find in you our life. Please be seated.
We call our younger friends forward, and as they prepare for Sunday school. Yeah. All right.
She's probably in that tween age. You know. I don't know. I don't want to call your age out in public, but I'll let your parents decide if you're the age or not. You know.
All right.
Or you can be an assistant if you're too old. How's that? No? Okay.
Let us reach out over our friends as we pray. Lord God, we thank you for our friends, our children, our sisters and brothers. We thank you for hearts eager to learn, and we thank you for the teacher. We thank you for your presence in the midst of this class as they pursue instruction. Glory of your name as they look toward Jesus and trust in the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
A few announcements from the church. Monday-Thursday service will be held on April 14th at 6 p.m. The service will start outside and then move inside. Resurrection Day Sunday service will be April 17th at 6:30 a.m. I hope you can all make it. Thank you.
That's all.
Yeah, that's a sunrise service. Always a good time, and the worship committee promises some food at the conclusion of that service. Not just food, but what we used to call in the Army fat pills, donuts. And so if you're a fan of donuts or not a fan of donuts like me, it's an excuse to eat some. So bring plenty, Leon Kelly. Thank you. Today we're going to start with the scripture out of the Hebrew scriptures, Isaiah 43, verses 16 through 21. The Hebrew scriptures declare that the history of the ancient Hebrew people and the whole world is guided by God. The Lord says, "Who makes a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters? Who brings out chariot and horse, army and battalion? They will lie down together and not rise. They will be extinguished like a wick. Don't remember the prior things. Don't ponder ancient history. Look, I'm doing a new thing. Now it sprouts up. Don't you recognize it? I'm making a way in the desert, paths in the wilderness. The beasts of the field, the jackals and ostriches will honor me, because I have put water in the desert and streams in the wilderness to give water to my people, my chosen ones. This people whom I form for myself, who will recount my praise." Holy wisdom, holy word.
Close the eyes of your soul to see what is needed. True.
The second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, home of Lazarus, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Lazarus and his sisters hosted a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who joined him at the table. Then Mary took an extraordinary amount, almost 3/4 of a pound, of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She anointed Jesus' feet with it, then wiped his feet dry with her hair. The house was filled with the aroma of the perfume. Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, complained, "This perfume was worth a year's wages. Why wasn't it sold and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He carried the money bag and would take what was in it. Then Jesus said, "Leave her alone. This perfume was to be used in preparation for my burial, and this is how she has used it. You will always have the poor among you, but you won't always have me." Holy wisdom, holy word.
As a swimmer, I'm always memorizing a pattern or a combination to open some locker somewhere to access my stuff. And no matter how many times I use a particular pattern or combination, there's always that moment of doubt. And then that's quickly followed by joy, because I opened the thing. It's always that moment of doubt followed by, very quickly, by a moment of joy. Where I swim now, there's a combination of different patterns and a lock combination built into the locker. And it's a lot to hold on to after a good swim, a good workout. So occasionally, and it's happened to me, you see someone having to leave the locker room, walk down the main hallway to the front desk, ask for a key to get the locker open. They forget the pattern. There's a sequence of things that people have to do. So every once in a while, you see someone 70 plus in a Speedo walking down the hallway. But what I want to talk about today is that word pattern. Pattern. So, you know, in junior high, the pattern to open the lock was to throw that master lock 3 times to the right, stop at your first number, 3-number sequence, turn around, pass the number once, stop on your second number, and then turn to the right and stop on your 3rd number to open your lock. That was the pattern. God operates in history with a particular pattern, and that pattern is something that we can lean into. That pattern is something we can trust. That pattern is something to give us encouragement for the living of our days. In the midst of a historical crisis moment for God's people, the people receive a reminder of God's pattern of history, God's pattern in history as a source of encouragement. God repeatedly makes a way out of no way. We remember the Exodus and the escape from Egypt. God intervenes and delivers the people. Here in the book of Isaiah, the prophet recalls the pattern and then says, God is about to do a new thing. In the midst of a historical crisis, the people receive a reminder of God's pattern and add to the encouragement with the reality that God is about to do a new thing. Do you not perceive it? We read. The pattern, there is a pattern here. Have confidence in that pattern that opens opportunity when there seems like none. So back to that first day of junior high gym class, and the gym teacher stood up in front of us and said, hey, turn three times to the right with our master locks. Turn to the left, pass number one, stop at that second number. Turn to the right and hit that third number and open the lock. And I just took it for granted that all people of a certain age knew that was the pattern. So I met a fellow swimmer from Russia, and he was upset that when he joined the Navy, he didn't know the pattern, and he was frustrated. So when you're a recruit, there's many things to know, and the people raised in the States had one less thing to worry about when all this information is being thrown at you. When we don't know the pattern, we keep turning and turning the dial. Frustration. When it comes to life, know God's pattern in history. The pattern is there's a situation, there seems like no way out, and then God comes in with a new thing, either in promise or with the new thing. Do you not perceive it? When you buy a lock, you typically get a little piece of paper with the combination on it, and Lent, metaphorically speaking, is a time to find where that paper is. You need that pattern. You need that combination for the living of your life. Or if you misplace it, here's an opportunity to find it. Or if it's faded, rewrite the numbers. It's a time, Lent, the days leading up to Easter, the days leading up to our celebration of the resurrection. Lent, we call it Lent, it's a time to reconnect, return, renew, reignite. You know the pattern. Trust it. God is about to do a new thing. So you turn to the right, turn to the left, fork in the road. Should I stay or should I go? Fish or cut bait? Often we find it's decision time. Living in cities, where most of us have our homes, the agricultural images in our passages of Scripture might not speak to us in the same way that they did for the original audience. Yet the pattern is still good to go. So instead of the images in our biblical passage today, we might dream of just city governments, beaches free of pollution, affordable homes, medical costs within reach. These may be a parallel to thinking about when we read in the Scripture, making a way in the desert, pass in the wilderness. The Scripture says, the beasts of the field, the jackals and ostriches will honor me because I have put water in the desert and streams in the wilderness to give water to my people. Yes, regardless of the context, God still speaks. God is about to do a new thing. You know, when we prepare for a trip or a vacation, we collect brochures, we Google search and look up different reviews, and we get maps, and we might look at an aerial view of the place and look at the restaurants that are nearby where we are staying. We put in a lot of work for our trips in preparation for a trip or a vacation. But all the planning, even the dreaming, is within the realm of possibility. We can picture it. We can see it. Even if it's fancy, it's still within whatever might happen in our minds is in the realm of possibility. But what we're talking about today is outside the realm of what is possible. When we talk about God doing a new thing, we're talking about things like the Exodus and people facing water and God parting the sea. We're talking about exile, people feeling defeated, ready to give up, no hope, and there's the promise in Scripture of God doing new thing. We deal with death, and we are reminded of the resurrection, God's victory over death, God proving in Jesus Christ that God not only promises a new thing, but that God brings a new thing, a new thing, a new thing, a new thing, outside the realm of possibility. So regardless of where you are in your personal story, it's God's story of doing a new thing, promising a new thing that gives us hope. And so our story combines with God's story in such a way we become filled, if we believe in this new thing, we become filled with possibility and live our lives accordingly. God's about to do a new thing. Now, you might say it's just words on the page, but we're talking about faith. We're talking about trust. We're talking about possibility. We're talking about a story. We're talking about your story. We're talking about our story. God is about to do a new thing. Do you not perceive it? Amen.
Please join us in singing Blessed Assurance, number 508 in the African American Heritage Hymn.
Let us pause for prayer. Let us pray. And loving God, pour out the costly gift of your grace upon us. Fill our homes and our lives with the fragrance of your love, so that we may show your glory and serve your people with the same extravagant love you show us in the Gospel of John read today. Bring that new thing to our relationships, our experiences and situations. Bring it to the world. Lord, have mercy. We remain in prayer in this season of funeral after funeral after funeral, heaviness on our hearts, wars and rumors of wars. Lord God, hear us. Lead us, Jesus. Guide us, Holy Spirit. Guide us as we pray together, as we have prayed together for centuries. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We continue in worship, celebrating and sharing our gifts. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord God, we thank you for all that you grant to us, the resources for us. Hear us as we give thanks, not only with our mouths, but with resources you have provided in return. May these resources be used wisely and to the glory of your most holy name. Amen.
Please be seated.
come to this table, those who have much faith and those who would like to have more, those who have been here often and those who have not been here for a while, those who have tried to follow Jesus and those who have failed, come. Everyone is welcome at this table, welcome to engage the mystery of God and community at this table. Let us share in the great prayer of thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to our walk and sanctuary.
Blessed are you, O God, who have brought forth bread from the earth. Blessed are you, O God, who have created the fruit of the vine. And if again you watered the earth that man and woman might have food and drink, you gave your servant Sarah bread to strengthen her family on their journey and wine to make them glad. You called Moses and his people out of bondage and refreshed them with food in the wilderness. You gave Mary and Jesus their daily bread to share. And here at the table you offer us bread and wine for the journey to nourish the sons and daughters. And so with all our brothers and sisters before us and beside us, we praise you from our hearts for your unending greatness. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of me." Every time we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you. A reminder, especially for those, of you with us for the first time, you have two cups stacked, and the bottom cup is the bread, and the top cup is the fruit of the vine. The body of Christ broken and shed for you. The new covenant sealed in the blood. Let us pray. Lord, you have put gladness in our hearts. You have satisfied our hunger with good things. In giving all, you have not withheld from us your own dear Son, your very self, our Lord and our God. Renew us day by day with the gift of your Spirit, that we may give ourselves completely to your service and walk with joy in the footsteps of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us stand. As many of you know, BJ also hails from the great state of New Jersey, and I could picture my favorite hero from New Jersey, and my favorite hero in general, Paul Robeson, hearing that song and Paul Robeson smiling, saying, yes, the tradition continues in this age of synthetic hair and synthetic music. We can still bring the real. And, you know, if that might be our mission to the world, to keep the real on the table to the glory of God.
Amen.
Go out into the world in peace, have courage, hold on to what is good, return no one evil for evil, support the weak, help the suffering. Honor all people, love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord be kind and gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.